I think we're ready to begin. Let's see, can you advance? Yeah, thanks. Good morning. If we could get started. I'd like to welcome everyone, both in person and online, to the Kislak Center for Special Collections, Rare Books and Manuscripts. We're holding the 15th annual Schoenberg Symposium on Manuscript Studies in the Digital Age. Many of you, almost 250, possibly more by now, are or will be joining us by Zoom from various places around the world. And while we cannot see, we're so glad that you're here and we're grateful for your interest and your participation from afar. My name is Lynn Ransom. I'm the curator of programs at the Schoenberg Institute for Manuscript Studies here at the Kislak Center and one of the organizers of this year's symposium. As you all know, this year, the topic is translating science. Some of you may know that we actually first planned this event, the 13th annual Schoenberg Symposium, to be held in the fall of 2020. And this was to celebrate the appointment of last night's keynote speaker, Ellie Truitt, as an associate professor at Penn in the Department of History and Sociology of Science earlier that summer. Ellie, a longtime supporter and friend of the Schoenberg Institute, and as you heard last night, a brilliant scholar of medieval science. We were, and we still are, thrilled to have her at Penn and excited to be able to work with her directly to draw attention to the important and often underused resources that we have at Penn for the study of the global history of pre-modern science. The 2020 conference was to be our first opportunity for that collaboration. During the planning of the symposium, which began early that year, Ellie and I worked together to define the topic and began preparing the program. And this, of course, was happening as the world was shutting down. And it soon became clear that as an event that we really wanted to hold in person, it just wasn't going to happen. So here we are, 2 years later, finally able to gather in person, but with the added dimension of a hybrid experience, excuse me, that allows us to reach audiences beyond Penn and around the world. The wait then hasn't been all bad. I can't tell you how glad I am to finally be standing here with you right now to welcome everyone here and most, if not all, of the original speakers, as well as some wonderful new additions. So thank you all so much for your patience and understanding and flexibility over the course of the past 2 years. Before we begin, as always, I have a few more acknowledgments to make and some housekeeping items to share. First, I want to remind you that we're being recorded via the Zoom webinar. For questions from the audience, we will be asking in-person attendees to speak into a microphone in order to be picked up by the recording and so that the people in the Zoom webinar can hear. We'll also be taking questions from the Zoom. So these can be posted in the chat, which I think is open, as well as a Q&A, and someone will read them out. Also, for the in-person attendees, I want to draw your attention to the refreshments that are being provided during the short breaks. You can find these, if you haven't already, behind us and to the left of the elevators. And we'll also be hosting a reception there Saturday night, to which everybody's invited, which will give us an opportunity to kind of relax informally over a glass of wine and some delicious treats that have been arranged for us by the Penn Library's events manager, Alita Arthurs, who has done brilliant work in pulling this all together at a very, very busy time of the year. We also have on view during the afternoon lunch breaks, a selection of manuscripts related to this year's topic. During the long breaks at lunch, we encourage you to visit the historic Henry Charles Lea Library, which is located just behind us, and to the right, from my perspective, of Ben Franklin's desk and his little teapot to see some of the treasures of our collections. My colleague, Nicholas Herman, who's here, or maybe still arranging books. The Lawrence J. Schoenberg Curator of Manuscripts has selected a daily rotation of manuscripts relevant to the various talks for both days on subjects related to medicine, pharmacology, alchemy, astronomy, engineering, hydraulics, and veterinary medicine, as well as many other topics. It's a great opportunity to get up close to the books and to speak to Nick about the collections, and I think he'll be in the room during the breaks. So I hope many of you can take advantage of this opportunity, and we'll also be showing the Saturday selections. Oh, here comes Nick. At the end of the day on Saturday during the reception. I also want to draw your attention to a current exhibition that is being held here on the sixth floor. Somewhat unrelated, though no less interesting, the exhibition features selections from the contemporary photographer Arthur Truss's collection of Japanese illustrated books, a collection that spans four centuries of bookmaking in Japan. This is in the Goldstein Family Gallery, again, back into my left, which is next to the reception area. So where the coffee is this morning, the Goldstein Gallery is through the doors, and I encourage you to pop in and see some really delightful books. Two-day symposium like this takes a lot of behind-the-scenes work to pull off successfully. So I want to take this opportunity to thank everyone who has made this event possible. Or not everyone, or we'd be here for the next hour. First, our colleagues at the Free Library of Philadelphia who hosted the keynote lecture and gave us a fantastic start to the event. I'd also like to thank my colleagues at the Schoenberg Institute and the Kislak Center, including Nick Herman, Doc Porter, who is in the back doing the questions in the Zoom this morning. Mitch Frost, who is in the back, as well as Amy Hutchins, who's also here, Doug Emery, and many, many others who really come together at times like these to help these kinds of events come up. And Sean Quimby, I don't want to forget Sean Quimby, who's the director of the Kislak Special Collections and will be joining us later today. I've already mentioned Alita Arthurs, who works incredibly hard to keep us supplied with everything that fuels a conference, coffee, refreshments, alcohol, even donuts tomorrow, I've been promised. Thanks also go to our Penn Library's IT support manager, Betsy Deming, and her team. Betsy is in the back. And she'll be seated in the back throughout, or someone from her team, the next 2 days and following along to make sure that the technology delivers to those on Zoom. Finally, I want to thank Barbara Bristol Schoenberg, who unfortunately, because of Hurricane Nicole, was not able to leave Sarasota yesterday, but she'll be joining us by Zoom throughout today and tomorrow. Barbara, we're all waving to you. We miss you. We wish you could be here, and we're hoping that you're staying safe and dry. Barbara's unending and enthusiastic support of the work we do at the Schoenberg Institute to bring manuscript culture, modern technology, and people together to bring access to an understanding of our shared intellectual heritage inspires us to continue building upon her husband and our founder, Larry Schoenberg's legacy of promoting open data and sharing knowledge about pre-modern manuscript culture. You can see his impact in the Schoenberg database of manuscripts, which is used by provenance researchers around the world, and an open, our fully open access repository of digital assets where all of our manuscript metadata and images are available to the world for free without even having to ask us. And it's not just Penn, it's all the Western manuscripts in the Philadelphia area collection, as well as Islamic manuscripts from Penn, Free Library, and Columbia, and other institutions in the area. We also have our journal Manuscript Studies now entering its 8th year of publication, conveniently put out for you to enjoy and subscribe to out front, among many other programs and projects that fill our days. But it's this symposium, now unbelievably to me, in its 15th year, where I feel that we really get to the heart of what Larry intended when he gave his collection to Penn. and that is bringing people together in conversation to share the latest research on topics concerning his collection and to learn from one another. The topic of the first symposium, held in 2008, was also about science, chosen to celebrate the strengths of the Schoenberg collection in pre-modern science, medicine, and technology. But this year's topic really speaks to Larry's passion. Above all else, Larry was fascinated by the transmission or the translation of knowledge, especially in regard to scientific theory and practice, from ancient times to the present day. In his collection of almost 300 manuscripts, one can trace the movement of human scientific thought, beginning with Aristotle, Ptolemy, Galen, Dioscorides, among many others, through the writings and translations of Arabic and Jewish philosophers and scientists, including Avicenna, Isaac Israeli, again, among many others. And then the translations of these texts into Latin and vernacular European languages. Going the wrong way. So LJS 24, for example, what you're seeing here, is a quintessential example of a Parisian 13th century medical textbook. It contains an introduction to Galen, which was composed by Ishaq ibn Hunan in the 9th century, an Arabic scholar who translated Greek scientific and medical texts into Arabic. The manuscript also contains copies of two texts on the pulse, one by the 7th century Byzantine physician Philaretus, and the second by the 13th century physician Gilles of Corbeil. And these texts are accompanied by another text concerning diet, urine, fevers, and the elements that was composed in the 9th century by Isaac Israeli, a Jewish physician for the Fatimid Caliph, Abdullah al-Mahdi Bula. The extent of the Schoenberg collection also reaches into the East, giving us insight into the transmission and dissemination of scientific knowledge and practice in Eastern traditions. For example, LJS 433, produced in Japan around 1600, contains an illustrated Chinese text on the treatment of abscesses and tumors, and shows through the act of non-translation of keeping the original language of the text, it shows the influence of Chinese medical theory and practice in Japan. These manuscripts exemplify, to me at least, the unambiguous cultural and intellectual diversity underlying the complex networks through which scientific thought passed and was translated across linguistic, geographical, cultural, and disciplinary boundaries from ancient times to the present. And it is these networks of exchange, transmission, and translation of natural knowledge evident in manuscript culture in the pre and early modern periods that this symposium seeks to integrate, interrogate, and explore. We have much to look forward to in this program, so I will end here with my introduction and hand this exploration over to our speakers and to you, the audience. And so now I'd like to invite the moderator for the next session, Haroon Kucuk, who's an associate professor of early modern science in the Department of the History and Sociology of Science here at Penn. Welcome, Haroon, and the first speakers.
Good morning. This is a wonderful session that I'm very interested in. Sadly, I'm just a moderator. So I will just say so both Eric Gurevich and Shirin Hamza are medievalists. I would say they both work on the Indian Ocean world, broadly conceived. And they are, you know, two of the most promising medievalists of their generation. And they will be speaking to us about language very generally, and you know, just from the abstracts in very interesting ways. And I look forward to hearing them. So Shirin is hailing from Harvard, the not the real Cambridge, Cambridge, Massachusetts. And Eric, you know, having finished his dissertation recently at the University of Chicago, is now joining us from Vanderbilt. So thank you.
Thank you so much. That was very generous. Before I start, I just wanted to take a minute to breathe together. If you'd like, you could close your eyes. I'm going to close my eyes. And as you're breathing, just want to feel gratitude for myself, for my body, for getting me here, to all the people in and out of the room whose work made it possible for me to be here. And also to the people who have stewarded this land for a time scale that I find very hard to understand, even the Lenape. And just want to give myself permission and all of you that were here in this room talking about bodies for 2 days, but whenever you need to take care of your body, should be giving myself permission and anyone else who needs it. Okay, so there is no telling the history of sciences in the Islamic world without translation. On the one hand, the phrase Islamic or Islamicate world, as some prefer, can include regions where such a vast number of languages were spoken and written that translation's a given. It's a necessary part of any continuities across such a mind-boggling space. And looking at this representation of the extent of Ibn Battuta's travels may give us some sense of this. But on the other hand, people who write about translation in the history of science usually focus solely on the Abbasid era translation movement, centering the textual translation of knowledge from Greek to Syriac to Arabic. It is implied narratives that Greek is one thing, Arabic is quite another, and that the difference in language maps onto a distance between these cultures. Never mind that two or three of these languages coexisted within the bodies of the translators themselves. The idea that translating pre-modern scientific texts is to cross a vast cultural distance is what glorifies narratives of translation for modern purposes, a time when internationalism is at least a professed value of science. There are many other reasons Greco-Arabic translation has taken on an emblematic role in scholarly and popular narratives alike. I was handed an Urdu booklet about this topic at an event in Aligarh in northern India, which could be the subject of its own presentation. And we'll hear more about these potentially from Ahmed this afternoon, but I will leave it at colonialism and push on further south of Baghdad, where we will encounter other tales of science and translation and query whether they are indeed cross-cultural. In my dissertation, I'm contributing to the effort to move beyond the traditional focus on the Near East by studying how Muslim scholars around the medieval Western Indian Ocean world adapted tib, or medicine, to their local concerns in three regions, northern Egypt, western Yemen, and western India. Taking a cue from the way the organizers arranged the program, I'll actually start with Rajasthan and Gujarat, western parts of the Indian subcontinent, and only then move westward and back in time to the more familiar context of Cairo. As I hope to show, Islam itself can be a technology of trans-regional knowledge production, which enables Muslim scholars to bridge multiple ways of knowing. In both settings, male physicians with very strong opinions wrote autobiographies about their lives practicing medicine, which they referred to as tib. Read together with their medical texts, these autobiographies can help us understand how these physicians understood their own translations or engagements with translated texts. The two earliest surviving texts of tib composed in Gujarat were authored by Shihab Nagori at the end of the 14th century, just as the Muzaffarid Sultanate of Gujarat was founded. These were Illness's Cure, a short handbook of medicine written in rhyming verse in 1388, and then 4 years later in 1392, the Khan's Cure, a much longer prose text. You may already know of Nagori from the work of Fabrizio Speziale, who focused on Nagori's hybridization of three Ayurvedic doshas and the four Galenic humors, resulting in four humors, phlegm, blood, bile, and wind. As may be apparent here, Nagori includes all of this medical knowledge, regardless of origin, within his concept of tib. Within the opening chapters of his first book, Illness is Cure, Nagori uses the words tib and hikmat interchangeably for medicine and refers to those who practice hikmat as hakims, regardless of the region they are from or whether they rely on the three doshas or the four humors. And this is why I do not refer to Thib or Hikmat as Galenic or Greco-Arabic or any other kind of medicine, just medicine. What constitutes Thib is highly contingent for each author, or rather for each and every text. And while some people do use Thib to refer to a specific tradition linked with Galen, others widen its boundaries to include a range of textual and other healing knowledges. From Bukhari's autobiography, which I have published in full in the journal Asian Medicines for anyone interested, we learned that his family hailed from Ghazni in what is now Afghanistan, and several generations before his birth, they migrated to Nagaur in Rajasthan. And quote, not one of them was a physician. His ancestors were given the land grant of Nagaur for 8 years. But after suffering a loss in stature, they turned to administrative work, ilmi tahrir. Like his father, Nagori himself worked in administration and accounting. Later in life, he likely moved from Nagaur to Patna, Gujarat. Manuscripts of his texts then circulated widely across the subcontinent, east to the Chachmal Fort, pictured here, and south to Srirangapatna in Karnataka, which Eric is going to teach us much more about after this. The regions pictured here also give us a sense of the varied sources that Nagori drew on to learn medicine in the first place. After his father became influenced by the Islamic teachings of one Husam Ali, presumably a Sufi, he left administrative work for humbler pursuits. Nagori soon followed suit. He says, quote, I became passionate about the science of medicine, ilmi hikmat, through which I would find the solution to each affliction. The books of medicine came into my possession, but how can one study without a teacher? Muhammad, a physician, came from Kabul. His words were full of wisdom about this weighty science. He raised the standard of travel, and by the grace of God, he reached this region. But he kept himself hidden. He did not impart this knowledge to anyone else. Because he became ashamed of my attending to him, he said, bring forth your medical papers. The book was composed by Hippocrates. Its principles were lofty. I benefited from this lofty and ordered knowledge through his generosity. This lengthy passage about Nagori's studies with Hakim Muhammad of Kabul is not the only time Greek authorities are mentioned in the text. He also does so in the first chapter of Illness's Cure, where he refers to Hunayn ibn Ishaq's work to explain the history of medicine in brief. The foundation of medicine, Bunyad-e-Tib, was built on the divine gift of this knowledge to Adam, a revelation brought forth by Gabriel. One of these words for revelation here is associated with prophets, with revelation to prophets. Thus, Tib or Hikmat is second only to religious knowledge, Ilmedin, in Nagori's eyes. Medicine was then built up over time through the experience, Tajriba, accumulated by each generation of teachers and students who wrote some of this knowledge in books, the first of whom was Asclepius. Eventually, it made its way to Hippocrates. In a versified handbook of medicine, copied often in a mere 35 folios or at most 85, and occupied in the main with, you know, describing and treating ailments from head to toe, it is striking that Nagori makes room for this history of medicine and for the autobiographical material in his text. The desire to situate Thib and to situate himself within it could also reflect on his outsider status, being the first in his family to study medicine, or on his instability, living as he did in a time of tumult and war. Returning to Nagori's description of his studies with Hakim Muhammad, it is all the more interesting when compared with the next verse. Passion for medical knowledge grew within me until I began to frequently attend the yogis. Kardam bisi khidmate yugyan. We do not find out the names of the yogis. We don't find out where they're from, what books Nagori studied with them, if any, or what Nagori meant by attending to them, khidmat. This singular verse is perhaps a clue as to where Nagori might have learned about the three doshas and the knowledge of Hakims of Hindustan. But this is never explicit. Nagori then proceeds directly into a description of his own experiences practicing medicine, including his dissatisfaction with his patients. Is Nagori's study of Hippocrates in Western India cross-cultural? Is his study with the yogis cross-cultural? Should we, as critical historians, say yes without acknowledging what Nagori himself might have had to say about it? Attending closely to the words of Nagori, I feel that he doesn't seem to have traversed any vast distance to study medicine, or to have been bewildered by something vastly unfamiliar. He sought knowledge, he realized that he needed teachers, and he found them in his local environment. He narrated the history of medicine as a continuous transfer of knowledge, springing originally from the true source and making its way finally to him via a variety of hakims. The only journey he narrates is this, his story of leaving the court, forsaking wealth, and embracing asceticism to walk the path of Islam. Leaving home for the wilderness or to seek out yogis was, by the 14th century, already a trope in Indo-Persian literature, drawing both from Indic and Persian epics, as well as oral traditions in vernacular languages. And it would soon become far more popular and far more localized with the spread of Sufi romances and bhakti in the following centuries. Nagori leaving courtly life and the realm of power to study with hakims and yogis was one established way of being Muslim in this period. And this path shaped the way that he studied and formulated medical sciences at that stage in his life. Nagori ended illness's cure emphatically by saying he would not devote this text to any ruler, only to God. But within 4 years, he had already named his second text after the founder of the Gujarat Sultanate, Zafar Khan. Any mention of the Hakims of Hindustan are absent from this introduction, which quotes from the Quran and the Hadith in Arabic and includes many verses of Nagori's own composition in praise of Zafar Khan in Persian, a great ruler who overcame rebellions and established peace and order. Even within a single lifetime, we cannot pin down this single Muslim scholar's way of relating to Indic knowledge, which transformed in relation to his faith, his financial situation, and the circumstances arising from the astounding military expansion of Zafar Khan. Because Nagori incorporates Ayurvedic concepts within illness's cure, it has received much more attention in research scholarship than his lengthier second text. And Tibbi Shahabi is the same as illness's cure. That's actually the name that practicing Hakims today most commonly use to refer to his text. So kind of used to using that name. Modern scholars have elevated Nagori's engagement with Ayurveda over any other aspects of his medical epistemologies, including his encounters with and attention to Sufi sheikhs, whom he mentions multiple times throughout both of his texts. Just as European Orientalists were initially interested in many Arabic scientific texts for their connection to ancient Greek knowledge, authorities, and texts, I'm concerned that scholars of Thib in South Asia are reproducing this pattern, elevating any Persian or Arabic engagement with ancient Indic knowledge over a full appreciation of medical and scientific works. This is excerpt from a chapter of Illness's Cure about bladder stones, which, after a description of the ailment and recommendations for treatment, includes this long story that Nagori heard from his sheikh, Husam Ali, that as a child, the sheikh had a painful stone, which physicians despaired of curing without surgery. But just as everyone was weeping and despairing, a Sufi khaja arrived from Multan, bearing medicine from a king in Tabriz, and Husam Ali was cured. Nagori's story and the reception of his work demonstrate the imbrication of Western India in larger political and intellectual networks, especially those of multiple Sufi orders. Historian Jyoti Balachandran vividly illustrated the ways the very formation of Gujarat as a region came about in relation to this broader geography. The settlement of Sufis like Sheikh Ahmed Khatu in this frontier region came to be narrated as the very cause of the foundation of the Muzaffarid Sultanate. So a few decades after Nagori wrote his work, Sultan Ahmed I founded Ahmedabad as the new capital and built many structures from the Jama Masjid of Ahmedabad to the tomb complexes for foundational Sufi saints that Balachandran studies so beautifully in her work. And as the Sultanate became more established, there were others who patronized medicine. It's worth mentioning also that women across classes in Gujarat also shaped the infrastructure that enabled life and the preservation of health in this arid region, nearly 25% of the hundreds of step wells that have been excavated so far in Gujarat, including this one near Ahmedabad, were sponsored by women. And this well was built in 1485 by Dai Harir, who managed the household of Sultan Mahmud Begra. And we know this through a Sanskrit and a Persian inscription, which survived. Towards the end of the 15th century, the same Sultan, Mahmud Begra, the longest reigning Sultan of this dynasty, commissioned Hakim Ali Muhammad Asawali to translate an authoritative text of Ayurveda by Vaghbhata into Persian. This translated text was called Tibishifai Mahmud Shahi after its patron and was composed nearly a century after the Sultanate's foundation. This text too be implicated in many of the narratives that I fear will become consolidated around Nagori, praising a Muslim scholar for being able to break free of the stupor of religion in a period of decline and engage with ancient knowledge. But those categories don't work at all for understanding Thib in this region, just as they have been shown to be false for the Near East. Like Nagori, Hakim Ali Muhammad too framed his translation in Islamic terms and altered or omitted several passages from the text according to his sensibilities. But focusing on sex and gender, I realized that he did choose to translate certain discourses of gender hierarchy that emerged from law and customs or dharmashastra, finding acceptable several passages for translation that had material that had never been included in Thib before. And I can show an example of that in Q&A if it's of interest. Realizing that different androcentrisms were found commensurable by some medieval translators made me pause and ask, what exactly are we celebrating when we decide to celebrate scientific translation? In my remaining time, I will take us north and west and back four centuries to Fatimid Cairo. The study of Islam and science in a supposed periphery has offered us many resources to understand the multiplicity of ways of engaging with science and translation. So perhaps we can revisit an old friend with a new perspective. There is a lot published about Ibn Ridwan, but that being said, few of his works have been translated into English, and there are still several short treatises by him in manuscript that are unedited. Ibn Ridwan may not have become the subject of a modern stamp like his contemporary Ibn al-Haytham, but he sure got tongues a-wagging, and I think he would have wanted the stamp. What we know about Ibn Ridwan from biographers Ibn al-Qifti and Ibn Abi Usaybah, or from his rival, Ibn Butlan, puts the lack of biographies of physicians like Nagori and Asawali in sharp relief. His Ibn Ridwan's autobiography, or Sira, a word which literally means path or method, was included by Ibn Abi Usaybah in his biographical dictionary, The Best Accounts of the Classes of Physicians. And if you haven't checked out the online edition of this and translation, you have to, it's so good. Some have argued that this was originally meant to be included in a text by Ibn Ridwan about this autobiography was meant to be included in a different text by Ibn Ridwan about the best way to study medicine, Al-Kitab al-Nafi' fi kayfiyat ta'lim sina'at al-tib. And as such, quote, was not intended to be read as an independent tell-all report about his life, but rather as a protriptych to the study of medicine. But Ibn Abi Usaybah has the last word in his biographical dictionary where he reprints the whole, or includes the whole thing rather, and brings in many reports from Ibn Ridwan's rivals and contemporaries to complicate, if not completely contradict, the idealized picture that Ibn Ridwan paints about his own life. Ibn Ridwan wrote his autobiography at the age of 59. The text begins with him saying the astrological signs at his birth indicated that medicine should be his profession, a discipline which approaches philosophy in its obedience to God. As a teenager from a family without means, he first made his living sometimes by practicing the art of astrology and sometimes medicine. Still, by the age of 32, he had become a well-known physician who could earn more than what was needed through his practice. And though he doesn't shy away from mentioning that he practiced astrology, he doesn't mention that his dad was a baker. His biographers, especially Ibn al-Qifti, use these details about his class background as well as racialized descriptions of his appearance to ridicule him. It is little wonder that even after years as the court physician of the Caliph al-Hakim, he included the full horoscope of his birth in his autobiography, signifying that he was destined to be a physician. Eileen Das has shown that Ibn Ridwan's bookishness and autodidactism, actually, lies at the center of the controversy around his life, including his conflict with Ibn Butlan. His frequent invocations of Galen and especially Hippocrates function as his isnad, or his chain of transmission to medical knowledge, in the absence of any physical teacher. He too was an outsider to medicine, who made his way in part by arguing that he understood Hippocrates better than anyone else. I would argue also that the books he invokes in his autobiography show us more fully how translated texts of sages or arifin from Greek antiquity shaped his ethical self-constitution, even beyond medical practice. For example, the way he managed his household or estate was presumably fashioned after this text by Aristotle. Among a list of his own expenditures in the autobiography, Ibn Ridwan prioritized provisioning his household, as well as his family, claiming a dominant role in relation to other members of the home, possibly including women, children, servants, and slaves. As a Muslim scholar drawn to falsafa, Ibn Ridwan counted Aristotle, Galen, Hippocrates, and a range of other sages among those people who could teach him how to live, a rather intimate relationship. While all his hostility was directed towards his contemporaries, all his affection seemed reserved for these authors. In his autobiography, he portrayed an appropriate medical masculinity by emphasizing his status as head of household, earning and spending in a moderate fashion. This is a far cry from the asceticism of Nagori's path, but also emphasizes the importance of material circumstances to both authors in constructing an ideal medical masculinity. And as Erica Milam and Robert Nye argue, this portrayal demonstrates how, quote, longstanding masculine traditions in science are at once differentiated, flexible, nuanced, and incredibly persistent. There are many other facets of how he ideally viewed the relationship between books and experimental or practical knowledge. Ibn Ridwan did not value experiential knowledge as highly as logical argumentation, but he recognized the necessity for a physician to have both. While anyone can know things through experience, only the truly learned can understand the causes of phenomena and can choose the correct course of action. So for example, Ibn Ridwan says that when cold is most intense in Egypt, the best water to be found is in Tuba, which, quote, Egyptians know by experience. But while, quote, they store and drink it all year and they claim that it doesn't change, do not rely on that belief and purify it in any case. The physician is alert to the knowledge of his senses, but never deceived by them. While the surgeons and the oculists, quote, treat the old man and the small boy, man and woman, rich and poor, townsman and villager with the very same medicines, a physician is discerning. Other passages, however self-laudatory, give us an excellent sense of how Ibn Ridwan imagines physicians should put the books of Hippocrates to good use. They should constantly be searching for the correspondence between what they find in the text and the conditions of the season and region, the bodies of the patients, and the natures of medicines. For example, at the beginning of the chapter on seasons in Egypt, Ibn Ridwan says, Galen firmly believed that spring has a balanced nature, and in his book on temperaments, he refuted those who thought it was hot and moist. If we search in Egypt for something like this air, we would find it only during Aramshir, Baramhat, Ramuda, and Bashan. Sorry, I don't know how to pronounce these names of this calendar. There is a harmonious correspondence between what Ibn Ridwan sees when he looks into the book and out into the world. And so while he's depicted as this kind of like bookish and unoriginal thinker, I think he's using his experiential knowledge all the time. While many of the studies I have read about, which title themselves or include the term cross-cultural history of science, do not define culture, here is one example from a book that does, a book I found quite useful, Putting Science in Its Place by David Livingstone. He says these factors are not external to science, these factors listed here, but have profoundly influenced the doing of science in particular regional environments and the knowledge claims that practitioners have made. Even if we know these factors, styles of patronage, patterns of social organization, differed for Hippocrates, for Galen, for Ibn Ridwan, and Nagori, we have to take seriously the claims of intimacy and continuity made by the latter. To call them cross-cultural is to privilege our own sense of historicity and difference over their own sensibilities, which elides a major aspect of how and why they approach translation. I have sometimes slipped into using stagist and civilizational categories myself while writing about them. But while Ibn Ridwan and Nagori recognize the passage of time and its detrimental effects on their access to pure or unadulterated medical knowledge, neither would see himself as Eastern to Galen's Western, or as medieval to Hippocrates' ancient. As a medievalist, I find it helpful to remember that each text must be taken on its own terms when asking questions about culture. I can't know what Nagori thought, only what he wrote at one time or another in his life, and maybe he changed his mind and changed it back again and never put any of it on paper. So as things stand, I'm not ready to make a pronouncement about the culture of science in medieval Gujarat or Yemen or anywhere. But thinking through my frustrations with the term cross-cultural has helped me be a more sensitive reader of these texts and interpreter of these figures, gendered hierarchies notwithstanding, and to attempt to be as sensitive to them as I am to my contemporaries. So this is the journey I'm on, and I'm so grateful to be on it with all of you.
Okay, so we're talking about translation. We're talking about translation here in Philadelphia. We're talking about translation within the history of science. The past 10 years or so have seen the resurgence of talk of science and translation. Here's just a rather haphazard selection of recent collective projects on the topic. And I think among the people in the room, maybe two-thirds, three-quarters of us have contributed to one of these volumes. And I picked out the cover image of one of them, but you can determine which. But what are we talking about when we talk about science and translation? This symposium, I think, will help us arrive at some answers. But first, it might be helpful to note that talk of science and translation is not something new. Before Thomas Kuhn introduced the notion of incommensurability, it was common for historians of science to center translation and cross-cultural movement in their narratives of science. In many ways, we used to be a much more global profession and one much more interested in translation. But we should be wary of the dominance of this particular model of translation that centers the movement of knowledge. As Shireen has just argued, there is much at stake in associating linguistic translation with cross-cultural exchanges off the bat. It often presents a very particular image of cultures, and it prejudices analysis by creating stark divisions where there might not be any. Rather than treating language and culture as overlapping, we would do well to see a complex interplay of language and culture, of languages creating new epistemic cultures in unexpected ways, and of different languages having distinct roles within a single culture. Indeed, so we might do well to think of a myriad of ways people do translation or use translation to do things other than cross-cultural negotiation. We sometimes use translations to create codes to make ourselves illegible to others around us. We sometimes use translations to exhibit our erudition, our worldliness, to show off. And we sometimes use translation to work across divisions, class or otherwise, within a single society. So I want to start my presentation today with a similar concern, although take a slightly different tack. Recent interest in science and translation provides an opportunity to think about translation outside of models where linguistic translation is equated with cross-cultural exchange, where translation is seen as a sort of economic encounter, one in which epistemic goods are exchanged. And I've argued this elsewhere. There's nothing wrong with this narrative when it's used to describe specific cases, but when it is extended to all acts of translation, And when it comes to encompass all uses of translation, it has a distorting effect. So there are many moments when translation is used to affect the movement of knowledge, of information to new contexts, but it should not be presumed to be the norm or even the goal of most translations. I take my cue here from a short essay that Talal Asad wrote many moons ago. And I like this essay because even though much has been written about translation in the intervening years in a more systematic manner, it retains a rawness that I find instructive. His argument, in short, is aimed at the anthropologist, for him epitomized by Ernst Gellner, who sees their role as providing a cultural translation of bringing one culture into the linguistic and conceptual code of another. Asad, in a move now common among scholars, invites his readers to see translation as a process of power. It is through translation that the inequality of languages is revealed. Making a pragmatist turn, he argues that the cultural analyst needs to see how translation transforms language. There's a breaking down and reshaping of one's own language through the process of translation. Not only are languages transformed through translation, but sometimes new languages are made. It's not always the case that content from one language is transferred into another language, but sometimes one language is used to create a new one. And the translation defines the borders of languages as it seems to transcend them. And the sciences, with their rich vocabularies for cataloging the everyday objects and phenomena of the world, play a central role in creating languages. Here's where the history of science has a particularly important role to play in all theorizations of language, which are still dominated by literary analysts. Have the good stuff. So the turn of the first millennium saw the dramatic rise of new languages, often linked to specific regions, and most importantly, languages that were marked by their users as new. So the rise of a literary and bureaucratic language known as Dari, otherwise known as New Persian and distinguished from earlier languages, took parts of the Middle East and Central Asia by storm. And in Southwest India, a language called New Kannada began to be used for poetic expression, the functions of statecraft, and a range of everyday sciences. In particular, the Western Chalukya court of the early 11th century sponsored the production of texts written in New Kannada about a range of everyday activities: speaking language, locating underground water, counteracting the effects of poison, having sex, tending to horses and elephants, predicting the future, and cooking food. Collectively, the authors of these texts called their projects everyday sciences, and they invariably used the language of novelty to describe themselves. They also engaged in acts of translation. To give you a sense of how these different aspects of the project were brought together, I'll take us through a passage from the opening of a Kannada text about sex titled The Ornament of Desire, written by a scholar named Chandra Raja. So here's the passage. It consists of three verses. In the first verse, Chandra Raja calls himself the Lord of Poets. He boasts of his prowess in a number of arts and sciences. He's trained in various linguistic and poetic arts, philosophy, different types of performance, a host of practical sciences, and of course, sex. In the next verse, Chandra Raja goes on to insult his predecessors in the science of sex, including the famous Vatsyayana, the author of the Kama Sutra. All these people, Chandra Raja says, do not quite equal him. But after insulting his predecessors, Chandra Raja goes on to present himself as following after them. He says that he has in fact narrated the thoughts of great scholars such as Shweta Hetu, Jataka, Vatsyayana, and Panchala, shining in New Kannada. So just three things to emphasize here. One, a training in a wide array of arts and sciences. Two, a sense of superseding earlier Sanskrit scholarship while at the same time drawing on it. And three, a turn towards writing in a new manner in New Kannada. In fact, Chandra Raja does follow earlier authors of texts on erotics, translating prose passages from the Kama Sutra, among other texts. And the other authors of practical sciences in New Kannada from the 11th century did so too. In his Ornament of Astrology, Sridhara translated long passages from earlier texts. texts and the assistance for the people of the world. The governor Chavundaraya also drew on earlier Sanskrit texts. And in his five strategies in Kannada, the general Durga Simha likewise translated portions of an earlier Sanskrit text on political science. So translation played a central role in the creation of sciences in New Kannada. But translation is not all these authors did, because none of the authors translated an entire Sanskrit text. Instead, they took bits and pieces of earlier Sanskrit texts, translated them into New Kannada, rearranged them, and added their own observations and experiences. And these scholars theorized this practice, writing about the relationship between experience and erudition, past authority, and the everyday of the present. Let us take Chandraraja again as our guide, although the other authors I've mentioned might as well serve that role. He described his project as one that united what has already been said in the authoritative texts on erotics with worldly practice. Similar assertions are made in the other texts of this period. Translation served as a way scholars could frame their writing before going on to do something quite different than what had come before. It might make sense to pause here for a moment and ask, what was New Kannada? Recall my argument was that translation is sometimes used to make new languages and not simply to render old texts into a different medium. Well, it makes sense maybe to start by saying what New Kannada was not. It was not Old Kannada. Old Kannada had been discussed by a scholar named Srivijaya, who lived 150 years earlier in the same region. In his Way of the Royal Poet, Srivijaya set out the linguistic and literary standards that the authors I have discussed so far would use. And I should note that Devend Patel knows a lot more about him than I do. And he set out these standards in opposition to both Sanskrit language sectarians and people who use Old Kannada. There are some people, Srivijaya says, who demean Old Kannada and say that the well-established literature of Sanskrit and Prakrit should set the standard for poetry. But this fails to account for the aesthetic sense of the regional, a critical category for Srivijaya. He then goes on to provide some examples of Old Kannada phrases, which I must say I can't understand them at all. And he continues to state that Old Kannada is no longer fitting for expression. When they appear in the usage of ancient poems, Srivijaya writes, speaking of Old Kannada phrases, they are beautiful. But when it comes to the regional at the present moment, they're in poor taste. It would be as if someone had a special taste for making love to old women. Now, chauvinism aside, three things are clear from this passage. First, composing texts requires training in a tradition. It requires erudition. Second, the standard of composition is defined by a region. There's particular value to the local that is asserted at this moment. Finally, Old Kannada is insufficient for expression in the present. A new language is needed, New Kannada. So this text, The Way of Poets, served as a guide for authors writing practical sciences, I have already discussed. Durga Simha opened by praising The Way of Poets, calling Srivijaya a god. His colleague Sridhara began his ornament of astrology that he had by saying that he had conquered the fortress that is the Way of Poets, and our old friend Chandraraja likewise says that that's what made his text better in the sutra. Now that we know what New Kannada was not, we can begin to ask what it was. New Kannada was in many ways defined by a lexicographer and grammarian named Nagavarma, who was also employed by the Western Chalukya court in the 11th century, and who in fact edited one of the texts I have already mentioned, Durga Simha's Five Strategies in Kannada. Now, Nagavarma composed several texts, but the two I want to focus on today are two Kannada dictionaries. One's a commentary on what was then a recent Sanskrit dictionary from the region, Halayuda's Jewel Necklace of Nouns. The other is a freestanding metrical dictionary called the Treasury of Nouns. Nagavarma opened this freestanding Kannada dictionary by explaining his method, saying that he had brought together the earlier authoritative texts, such as the Treasury of Amara, those of Vararuchi, Halayuda, Bhaguri, Sashwata, and then composed his own text. I want to pause here to draw attention to the strangeness of this statement. In composing a new Kannada dictionary, Nagavarma opened by saying that he had relied on earlier Sanskrit dictionaries. These are all Sanskrit lexicographers he mentions. What does it mean to compose a dictionary in Kannada based on the work of Sanskrit lexicographers? For one, it meant that the work of lexicography is not just to define words, but to define objects. That is, the act of compiling a dictionary is in part an act of selecting what sorts of things in the world are worth defining. If Nagavarma provided Kannada names to things in the world, what those things are had been defined, at least in part, by those lexicographers who came before him and who described the world in Sanskrit terms. But composing a dictionary in Kannada based on the works of Sanskrit lexicographers also meant that Sanskrit words defined by those earlier lexicographers could be incorporated into the lexicon of Kannada. Through projects like this one, Kannada came to be a space in which Sanskrit words could sit alongside words from beyond the borders of Sanskrit. It's not merely that every Sanskrit word was shown to have a Kannada equivalent, but that every Sanskrit word was shown to have a Kannada equivalent and was also shown to be an acceptable Kannada word itself. Let's turn to an example to see how this worked. So these lexicons, both Sanskrit and Kannada, defined words by use of synonyms, fixing meanings with different names for the same thing. Take the following verse from Halayuda's Sanskrit Jewel Necklace of Nouns, dealing with botanical nomenclature. Nyotgundi is Sundubara, Mandara is Paribhadraka, Tambuli is Nagavali, Uvaka is said to be Puga. So this verse by Halayuda is entirely in Sanskrit. It provides synonymous glosses for plant varieties. Each Sanskrit name is placed next to another Sanskrit name, which serves to fix its denotation. In his commentary on this verse, Nagavarma glossed each pair of Sanskrit words with a new word. He wrote, Yodgundi and Sindhuvada, those two are Kosugu. Mandara and Paribhadraka, those two are Harivala. Tambuli and Nagavali, those two are the Elevine. Uvaka and Uga, those two are the Adaketri. So in effect, what he does here in this commentary is to add one more synonym to those that Halayuda had already collected. He defined each pair of Sanskrit words with a third word not found in Sanskrit lexicons. His goal was to show that the two languages can be fully calibrated. Each Sanskrit entry was given a non-Sanskrit equivalent. But when it came to his own formal freestanding lexicon written in Kannada, the Treasury of Nouns, Nagavarma did something rather different. Here's a verse from it dealing with similar botanical terminology. It said that Puga is Uvaka. The name Nagalata is known for Tambuli. Unaga is Suravalaba. Naga is Gajakesara. Lavanga is Valka. This should be familiar to us. Because with this Kannada verse defining plant names, Nagavarma took a different tack. What's notable about this passage is that every term that he defined, along with every synonym he provided, can be found in a Sanskrit lexicon. We just saw them. And yet, while all these words can be found in Sanskrit dictionaries, they're also Kannada words. Nagavarma selected them and applied case endings appropriate for Kannada words to construct a Kannada verse, thus showing their usage in New Kannada. His project was to expand language and to make Kannada a site where words from many different places could sit next to each other. Neither of his lexicons was meant to be exhausted. They provided an open-ended guide for the usage of words. Such a project can serve as a guide for other scholarly disciplines and is in fact the necessary basis for them. So he described the Treasury of Nouns as a lantern for all the sciences that can stave off the onset of mental darkness. And it was this register of language of New Kannada that Nagavarma described that the authors of everyday sciences used. These scholars used the translation of Sanskrit sciences to alter the meaning of scholarship and a scope of language. They turned their acts of translation into a thematic and then wrote about how they had superseded earlier scholarship by means of their situated knowledge in a particular region. We might call these sciences vernacular sciences, The language chosen by these authors was one that linked them to a specific region, to a limited locality. It allowed them to center themselves and their experiences and to change the epistemic basis of scholarship. To be frank, there was just a lot more barnyard knowledge. At times, translation was used to render information from Sanskrit into a new idiom, but it was also used to demonstrate authority over the past as well as a break from it. It was used to show the old so that what was new would be made evident, although at times it was also used to hide what was new and to make it seem old. One thing that translation was not used for in this context was to make knowledge travel. The Sanskrit texts often came from the same place as the Kannada ones. And authors never stopped writing in Sanskrit. The fact that Sanskrit scholarship never ceased meant that writing vernacular sciences always remained a potential epistemic intervention for scholars in southern India. So over a startlingly long period of time, hundreds of years, scholars wrote about making earlier disciplines new by writing in a regional language. Just to give one example, around the year 1300, so 300 years later, a scholar named Rutta composed a text about weather prediction that he modestly named after himself. He opened his text in a similar manner to how we have already seen, saying that earlier scholars such as Varahamihira and Gargya understood and narrated the signs of the rains. But it was not just these earlier scholars who made the signs of rain legible. Rutta would also say that the earth itself depicts the true signs of the rain. And he calls this a text called the Cacophony of the Clouds. After investigating the set of signs provided not by scholars, but by the earth, Rutta narrated it. Finally, he went on to say that it is of practical import to understand how the rain works. And so he made this knowledge new in Kannada. Vernacular sciences have an evergreen quality about them. By turning away from the hegemonic Sanskrit, scholars had the opportunity to keep their intellectual output fresh long after the initial texts of Kannada scholarship were produced. I would like to conclude my talk today by bringing it back to the history and the historiography of science. And I will do so by invoking Garcia de Orta, a Portuguese physician who traveled throughout Southwest India in the early 16th century, and who has become something of, let's say, a cult classic within a new global history of science that seeks to show how non-European places and peoples were implicated in the formation of modern science. Among other things, Orta sought to resolve a confusion regarding two plants whose leaves were often used in medicine. Oh, there's the global history of science. We'll be excited. It's great stuff. There's the plants. So these two plants that were confused that Orta sought to disentangle, one was the broad heart-shaped leaf of a vine that had long been consumed together with Arachia nut in South and Southeast Asia. The other was a long, thin, aromatic leaf that was dried and used in medicine throughout the Indian Ocean and Mediterranean worlds. This confusion was not founded on a similarity in plant physiology or pharmacological properties. Rather, it was a linguistic confusion. In Sanskrit and the vernacular languages of Western India that often derive botanical terminology from Sanskrit, the first plant was called Tambula, the second, Tamala. Orta provided a dramatic story of his education in these plants and their properties. As he explained it, after spending some time in India, he paid a visit to the court of the Sultan, who was then ruling from Ahmednagar, Buran Nizam Shah. One day while in Ahmednagar, wanting to make a drug for the stomach, Orta wrote that he gave a prescription for a simple he called Folium Indum. Recognizing the term, the Nizam Shah laughed at Orta and pointed him to a copy of, quote, Avicenna in Arabic, which showed Orta that he had confused two plants, both described in book two of the canon. So just to take a step back, Orta told his readers that European merchants confused two plants based on their misunderstanding of two similar Sanskrit-derived terms, Tambula and Tamala. To clear up this confusion, a king in a Persian-administered Deccan Sultanate appealed to an Arabic text that was regarded as authoritative by physicians from Lisbon to Malacca, Ibn Sina's Canon of Medicine. This, in turn, allowed Orta to make sense of a problem from Greek and Roman antiquity. Are you all with me? The plant known in Latin as malibatrum was nothing other than a corruption of the Sanskrit tamala, with the word for leaf, patrum, appended to it. Somewhere along the line, this initial T was lost. Rather dizzying. Now, there's reason to doubt much of this story, and we can discuss that in the Q&A. Instead, what I would like us to think about is how we talk about translation and how we talk about translation as circulation, as the movement of epistemic goods from one place to another. I want to suggest that this talk of circulation, at least of second order phenomena like knowledge, is a trick of the eye. So I like to think of an old fashioned theater marquee. Here's one from where I used to live. It appears as if a ball of light travels around the edges of the marquee. But of course it doesn't. Rather, the circulation of light is an inferred effect from individual light bulbs being illuminated in serial succession, one after the other, below the perceptual threshold of acuity. By focusing on the moving ball of light, we miss the whole apparatus that allows for such an illusion to take place. We should, as it were, turn on the lights on this illusion and instead focus on the light bulbs and how they've been arranged. Orta was not the first person to coordinate information about Kambula. If you recall the examples I chose from Nagavarma, you will have noticed they all had to do with this plant. Medical dictionaries translating between Sanskrit and vernacular terminology had been composed by scholars in the region writing in Kannada and Marathi. By the time Orta arrived in Southwest India, there was already a robust scholarly tradition that worked across languages and organized the complexities of the world. But more than that, the intellectual labor of making languages and then later making them equivalent had already been performed. This is what I want us to look for when I called my talk Before Translation.
So now is the time for questions. We have about 20 minutes. I was asked to keep questions brief and to the point, so it's very hypocritical for me to obey this order, but I will. So please, you know, if you have any questions, raise your hands and I'll try to direct the conversation as best as I can.
Hear me? Yes, everybody can. Hello. Thank you both so much. I want to combine both of your talks and ask a question. So Shireen, you talked about how the kind of continuity in these sorts of traditions is really persistent, although very context dependent, contingent, etc. And then Eric, you're talking about this this sort of moment of error introduced through translation and misunderstanding that is that around a plant that is then kind of like revealed in a way. And I've encountered the same thing in Bacon's work from the 13th century. And I guess what I'm wondering is it possible that that is itself one of these like rhetorical topoi around translation of natural texts, one of these kind of persistent things that we've been asked to think about? That's my question.
Topos of continuity or no?
The topos of mistranslation and error, especially related to some kind of like botanical thing that is about the sort of ignorance of the one who knows the language least in some way. And then it becomes sort of exposed in this like public, semi-embarrassing way that then becomes used as a pedagogical episode.
Okay. I feel like Eric will have more to say about this. I will mention that Ibn Ridwan actually goes into great detail about this in his Al-Kitab al-Nafi', the beneficial text on the way to study medicine, that he talks about like how do misidentifications happen over time. And so like one of the stories that he gives, it is often blaming non-literate people. The end result for him is always to lampoon other physicians. So he, there's a plant, and this is how it's described in Galen and Dioscorides. And if anyone, if any physician worth 2 cents, can see that what's being sold in the market is not that. But what really happened is like, 4 decades ago, this one merchant started selling it under this name, and then it became really popular. So he has like tons of stories like that. And I think it's really interesting to note that Nagori is not as, Ibn Ridwan is super philologically oriented and Nagori is not. Mm. Yeah.
That's really interesting to think about. And I have 3 short and I think contradictory answers. So the first is no. It's really important to know the difference between Tambula and Tamala. And it's actually fairly hard when you're dealing with dried specimens, when you're a long way away from where they grow. The second answer is, I was thinking about like what Shireen was just saying was this role of maybe like experiential philology of reading texts in a certain way as being a type of experience, and then the invocation also of experience in philology. So I think maybe we should be careful about where we divide those. And I think what Garcia de Orta is doing is experiential philology. He has experience in languages that allows him to disarticulate these texts. He's also in a place where these plants come from and he can see them, but that maybe might not be so operative for him. And my third answer would be yes, it's certainly a trope. And yeah, I don't know. I love this old philosophy of science essay that Ian Hacking has. Mm. Has there ever been a radical mistranslation? And his answer is no, but we always like to talk as if there were one. But yeah, I'll have to think about that more.
Yes. All right, this is a question from Zoom, and it's for Dr. Hamza. What are the main works in relation between astrology and medicine in the Arabic tradition?
I asked that. Sorry, the main works between astrology and medicine?
Yes, that's the question.
Well, thank you for making me a doctor.
I'm sorry.
Hopefully in May. But yeah, I feel like that might be beyond my purview for today. Fine.
Oh, I'm not going to respond to that. I do have a question for Shireen. And Eric, both of you for fantastic papers. My question is about the yogis for you. Within Islamic tradition, stretching back, to the late antique period, the Brahmins and the yogis are invoked over and over again. It's something that's within the tradition going back. You don't need to be at Nagori for that kind of this great Indic philosophy to be part of, a source for knowledge. So to what extent might that be contributing to his, his reference to place within the text?
Yeah, thank you so much. I think this is really important, and I didn't feel like I could get into the whole history from Firdosul Hikmah onward. But I think it is important that all of those references in the Arabic tradition are textual. And at least I haven't found until this period anyone saying I went and studied with them, like for medicine. Of course, there's, Al-Biruni and, lots of other examples of people who said I've gone and studied with them, but it's not necessarily something that then they textualize as like in a medical compendium. which is a genre so familiar, you know, like head to toe. So many of the categories are the Galenic category, but he wants us to know that he went and sat at their feet. And I think that's really interesting.
So thank you both for these talks. I mean, I find each of them very stimulating on their own and very convincing. And then together, there's a sort of resonance and dissonance that at least I perceive that I think maybe can be reconciled in an interesting way if you can do the work for me. With Shirin, I think you're extremely convincing in seeing that we can't look and say like every time anything's sort of supposedly being mediated from one culture to another, or like they're talking about Hippocrates is a totally sort of familiar figure, right? Not a foreign figure. And you know, you see with both of the figures you're talking about, and it's I think this is as you rightly say, a very widespread phenomenon. In a way, we have to listen to these sources and what they tell us about what they're doing. And on the other hand, we have the way I read Eric, I never thought of it this way. This sort of course, we talk about language creation through translation, but like or the creation of a technical vocabulary, but the way you're doing it, I think, is really in showing that it's this sort of very self-conscious process that is often a sort of construction of something that I like, especially what you say about hiding the newness of certain creating, like one thing that it can do is hide newness. So in all of this, if I can, sorry for such a long, what I wonder is, so in a way we have this sort of emphasis on what the scholars are telling us they're doing and the emphasis on like sort of reading against the grain of what they're doing, which is of course the sort of the traditional anthropologist conundrum as both of you in different ways have invoked. So I wonder if that is of, you know, you sort of impose your own, I want to tell this, I want to know about the story I want to tell, and I want to know the story that my actors are going to tell me. And so I wonder, is there some way to sort of, can we talk about a sort of whether something is being mediated across cultures or sort of clusters of cultural similarity or difference, or a sort of a conceptual similarity or difference in a way that sort of follows these light bulbs, these individual light bulbs, but also can give us some sort of a bigger phenomenon without falling in all the pitfalls that some of which you've identified. So that very brief question, I hope both of you can help me understand.
I'll give a very brief answer, which is that I think talk of newness does not always fully describe what's going on. But I think that talk of newness, wherever it happens, does something itself that is new. And there's a next stage to that. So what I want to do in looking at these authors who say they're writing in New Kannada, they're making this old stuff new, is to see what saying that does to what they do, I suppose, rather than seeing them saying that as describing retrospective.
That actually just makes me think so much about how also when something is new that's happening, sometimes you can't talk about it as new. I think there's definitely something very important in, and I also just think like there's probably so much wisdom in this room about this, but like it's so hard to understand the long durée of these knowledge traditions. Like I find it so difficult, especially with science, where, you know, we're, you know, cutting edge, and what do we do with that kind of idea of like the better, the newer, the better that we're raised with, I guess, if, depending on who you are, but versus like the older, the better. And I think that just even articulating that difference, I probably should have done this in my presentation, that for both Ibn Ridwan and Nagori, even though they're both doing a lot, you know, and they're, Nagori especially is doing, you know, I think a lot of it really interesting things. They don't want any aspect of the novelty to be perceived as such. They really want to say, you know, this is medicine. This is medicine. It comes from Adam. You know, it comes from God. That's what they want to say. So I think we have to grapple with that is one of the ways to like show the light bulbs is actually to just say, well, you know, rather than just be like, oh, look at this thing they thought, to really actually grapple with that. What does it mean to practice medicine that you think comes from a divine source and has only gotten worse over time?
Also, let me just
Yeah, sure.
I think, you know, that overwhelming weight of the assertion of Francis Bacon and early modern European scholars of newness is really weighing down on me, Shireen, as someone who works on sciences in the pre-modern, and then let's say the non-modern context. So that's the huge inheritance that I think is really still with our historiography.
I have a question actually for both of you. I mean, I'm somebody who kind of sat in a lot of rooms because I was working on a specific culture or because I was working on translations. And from your presentations, I'm hearing that maybe translation and culture have outlived their useful lives and we need to be looking at something else altogether now. First of all, you know, is that the sentiment I am getting from you? Is that an accurate description of like, you know, you're like, well, translation, you say culture, they don't mean much, black boxes of things that we can actually break down and understand better if we didn't talk about translation or about culture. Is that what I'm hearing? And I guess the follow-up question would be, what do you think is next?
I think I still think they're useful. I know I just diss a lot of things, but I do think they're useful. I just think that it's really hard to be careful with them. Like we have, I felt that for my work, I mean, the terms in which I'm talking about them are completely different from my perspective. Mm-hmm. You know, I don't use any of the words that I started out using. Because there's so many problems with them. And so I feel like we can use culture if we're like walking around with it as like, you know, an egg that we don't want to drop. And we're just like, that's how I feel about it. And that doesn't mean that it's not useful. It's just like, I feel like it needs a lot of extra care to figure it out.
I would say pragmatically, if it got you in the room, then we should keep it.
Oh no.
But
well, I mean, I'm trying to find new rooms, right? And I'm just trying to gauge if one were to open up a room that brought us all together that didn't involve like the cultural specificity of our, you know, subjects of inquiry and the fact of translation, what would that room look like? Yeah. No, I'm looking for new rooms, that's why I asked. Sorry for this very long question, but we do have another 5 minutes. Oh, we have somebody in the room. Yes. Zoom.
So we have. Okay, so we actually have, I don't know if we'll have time, but there are two. I'll ask the questions for both speakers. Given the issue of gender raised in the first talk, it is striking to see I'm having trouble seeing the Srivijaya quote, equating writing in archaic idioms with here negatively coded sex with older women. Is this a coincidence or a larger pattern? Could you both speak a little to how you see heteronormative erotics playing out in the way language choice / translation is framed in your sources?
Start with that. But I'll take it as I'll use that as opportunity to pivot, because yes, there is male chauvinism in almost all of the texts I'm reading, and I think Shireen, that was what you were talking about too. As much as you're recovering female voices, individuals. But my presentation sort of has its backbone in this text on erotics by Chandrarajan. And what I find really interesting about what he does with translation is he takes this typological thinking and translates it from Sanskrit. So he'll say, there are these four types of women, and then he'll list them. And he's translating from Sanskrit and Prakrit texts here. But then at the end of every time he does that, and it's maybe the first eight chapters of the text, it's like, actually, things are more complicated in the world. And that's where he builds on and critiques what has come before. So I think in that text, there's this really interesting admission that of a complexity that can't be enumerated and that can't be typified in the world. And then by the end of the text, it sort of just breaks down and that's all there is. So I find that an exciting way of sex and gender.
I'll just briefly add that, yes, there is like a ton of androcentrism in the erotological tradition. And the third text that I mentioned, that was a full translation of an Ayurvedic classic titled in translation, Dibishvai Mahmuchai, that it like brings even more exciting new like sexisms into the Persian tradition. I think, I will say, like, I do, like, I want to refer you to Sonia Wigg's work. And I do think, like, that the erotological tradition is actually the most popular of medical traditions. I would say, I don't know for sure for Arabic manuscripts, but definitely for Persian manuscripts in South Asia, that, like, you will find, for every one medical compendium, you'll find, like, five. Or some, I'm just pulling a number out, but I think, and even the texts that I'm talking about, they're these head to toe compendia, but they, if you look at the manuscripts of them, in the margins, you find so many handwritten recipes for, in the margins, in the beginning, in the end, you know, for aphrodisiacs, for remedies, for promoting fertility or abortifacients, you find all sorts of stuff. So I just want to acknowledge that that is of great importance to the readers.
We have a over here. Okay.
No pressure to have the last question, of course. again, thank you, both of you, for wonderful and stimulating presentations. I was curious about biomes. And Shireen, I love the way you set your presentation up with Western South Asia, Western Yemen, and then of course, the northern part of Egypt. I wonder if either of you would like to comment on natural setting in the sources that you study. As Hippocrates' best known and most read work throughout the Middle Ages and early modern period, at least in the Western tradition, was Airs, Waters, and Places, advising a physician to be very cognizant of all three of those factors in any new place that he goes. Could you talk a bit about the physical natural world in your sources and how it might relate to the translation issues that you speak about?
Going to be at HSS next week? Oh, okay. Well, the second to last text I spoke about, this one by Ratha, this weather prediction text, I think really uses the idea of a regional language to redefine how to look at the weather in a regional thing. We'll talk about that. But yes, in that particular, I don't see it in the medicine, honestly, but when it comes to predicting the weather, this linking of regional language with local perspective on the weather really alters what it means to do.
So Ibn Ridwan's treatise, the most well-known one on preventing bodily ills in Egypt, that some have said, you know, oh, this is a completion of Air's Water's Places because it talks about Egypt. And I think Ibn Rizwan would love that description. I think that in attending to the specificities of environment, the way that he does it, that's when we really get a glimpse of like who he is as a physician in a very interesting way, beyond the rhetorical things and the tropes and the, but I also think that a question for me is, besides his treatise, Ibn Jumay's treatise on Alexandria, and then there's another treatise by a Jewish physician, Egyptian physician, on comparing Cairo to Damascus. There's so few treatises like this that take the health of a city as a topic in Arabic or Persian. And I mean, given Air's Water's Places, you'd think, oh, there's going to be a manual for every city a physician could practice in on how do you administer to the health of the people in this place. So that is an ongoing question for me of like, why didn't that genre take off? You know, Ibn Ridwan's treatise doesn't survive in that many manuscripts, you know, it is. So, but it's really great. I like it because I'm interested in this. For South Asia, there's one person who puts it really clearly as that the, and he writes in the beginning of the 16th century, a Persian work compiling Ayurvedic material from many, many different sources. And he says, you know what, all of that Greek stuff, it's not for our climate. What we need is Indian medicine for India. And it's really striking because it's so strongly put. The text is the Ma'adunashif by Iskandar Shahi. It's so strongly put, but you don't see that. You know, all these people translating Ayurveda, that's not the claim they're making. So I would say it's not that as important to them as one would think.
And on that note, please give it up for Shireen and Eric. There's coffee just outside.
Yeah, coffee, and also restrooms are on that side, down the hallway about halfway.